So natural question is, can you use the data that you had to work out, so maybe the orbit of Earth is not a circle, the orbit of Mars is not a circle, can you work out the orbit of Earth and the orbit of Mars given the data that you have? Okay, so this is the data that Kepler had to work with. Now, this looks kind of impossible, because roughly speaking, you're trying to solve for two unknowns using one equation. Right? You have one set of data, the declination of Mars. You know what, at any given time, you know what direction Mars is in the sky, but that depends on both the orbit of Earth and the orbit of Mars, both of which are unknown. So you're trying to use one equation to solve two unknowns. Looks impossible. And also, you're only giving yourself half the information you really want. Okay, so Brahe's data tells you the direction of Mars. It doesn't tell you how far Mars is. You knew the distance. You know, polar coordinates need both direction and radius. You only have direction. So you're trying to solve for two unknowns using half an equation. Right? You only have half the data you need. Okay, and you want to solve for two unknowns. It looks really hard. Okay, so it looks like there's insufficient information to solve the problem. In fact, even this, so it looks like there's a curve-fitting problem. Like, this is a Cartesian plot. Descartes invented Cartesian plots about 30, 40 years after Kepler. he didn't even have this graph. He has this big table. It's really, again, they really had really serious limitations in their technology and in their mathematics. But nevertheless, Kepler solved this problem, and it's really an ingenious solution. It's really one of the great achievements, I think, in astronomy. So he made a couple of observations. So there are two unknowns. Okay, both the orbit of Mars and the orbit of Earth are unknown. But he reasoned that maybe if I could work out at least the orbit of the Earth, then this would help me work out the orbit of Mars. Okay, so if I knew how Earth moved around the Sun, this would be enough information to tell me the orbit of Mars. So how do you measure the orbit of Earth? You have to use another celestial body, you use Mars. Okay, now this how on Earth is this going to work? How? Okay. How is this going to work? Okay, so to explain how this works, okay, so let's reduce to an easier case, which is what mathematicians do. So both Earth and Mars move, but suppose Mars didn't move. Suppose Mars was nailed to space. Okay, so Mars is always here. Okay, only Earth moves. Okay. If only Earth moves and Mars doesn't move, then you can use Mars as a reference point to work out the measure of the distance of the Earth. Okay. Okay, so we don't know the orbit of Earth, but at any given time, wherever Earth is, you can see where in the sky Mars is. Maybe Mars is in Cancer or something, and so you know this direction. Okay, you know the direction to Mars, and you also know which constellation the Sun is in. You know the direction to the Sun. Okay, so you have this triangle. You have a fixed side and two angles that are known. Side angle side. Okay, that's enough information to determine the triangle. Okay, so you can triangulate. So this is an ancient navigational technique that even ancient Greeks, even ancient Phoenicians, I think, knew about. Like this. As long as you can see two landmarks on the coast, you can figure out where you are in the ocean using triangulation. Okay, and so once you know the angles, you can work out relative to these two fixed points where the Sun is, or where the Earth is. So triangulation is one of the oldest navigational techniques. We still use it, actually. You may not know it, but many of you may actually use it today. If you ever use GPS, okay, how GPS works is tetrangulation, really. You use four satellites instead of two points, and you're working four dimensions rather than two, but space and time. But it's the same principle. Right? You measure the time delays of signals in four GPS satellites. It's exactly the same method. Okay, but anyway, if Mars is fixed, then you can use triangulation, and you can work out the orbit of Earth. Okay. Of course, Mars moves. And so even if you know these two angles, the side keeps changing, and you don't know how the side varies. So this looks really bad. As Mars is moving in an unknown fashion, and so you don't get triangulation doesn't tell you where the Earth is anymore. But Kepler had one crucial additional piece of information from Copernicus's work, and I already told you about this. Every 687 days, Mars comes back to where it was. Okay, so you take Tao Brahe's data only at intervals of 687 days apart. And there's just enough data in Brahe's, there's like a 10-year data set or something, with gaps. There's, in winter you couldn't measure and so forth. Sometimes because Mars was below the Sun, the Earth. But there's just enough data that if you only take the data in series of 687 days, then Mars is nailed to space. And you can reduce the previous question, or pre- you spot. This is what amplitude is due. And that's enough information to work out the orbit of Earth at some points in time. And so that's using that, he was just enough data to actually work out what the orbit of the Earth was. And once he figured out the orbit of the Earth, he could use that to so then you take a different time series of 687 days. And then Mars is a different reference point, but around the same orbit. And because now you've computed the orbit, you can compare the relative position of this fixed point of Mars and this fixed point of Mars. And he was able to work out the orbit of Mars as well. It's an amazing piece of work, especially given, you know, he didn't have, you know, mathematical or anything. It was really quite an impressive achievement. And really an ingenious idea. Okay, so he worked out the orbit of the planets. Now, because nowadays it's very easy to do this because you can just look up Kepler's laws and show you what the answer is. Strange enough, he didn't have Kepler's laws at the time, but once he had this data for Mars and Venus and Jupiter and Saturn, he discovered Kepler's laws. The famous one. So he discovered that planets move in ellipses, the sun is one foci, equal areas for equal times, and then the hardest one, which actually required, I think he would do this for six planets, and this was just enough data, the most difficult third law, that the period of orbit has the power law with respect to the axis. Anyway, so he was able to discover some major scientific laws because of his very careful measurements, which, of course, famously led Newton to discover an even more fundamental law, which is basically the unique law that predicts that can recover Kepler's laws, which is, of course, Newton's law of universal gravitation. Okay, and so what this so what Kepler's method does is it allows you to measure the distance to any planet, Mars, Jupiter, Mercury, and so forth, in terms of the astronomical unit. Okay, so they all vary, they're all ellipses, but you could at any given point in time, you could say exactly how many astronomical units, how far away, say, Venus is. So this is, so some very precise measurements of other planets in terms of the AU using Kepler's method. So this is great because, as I said before, the AU is hard to measure, but you can reverse Kepler's measurements. If you could measure, say, the distance to Venus at any given point, so if I knew how far Venus was, Kepler said that at a certain point in time, Venus is so-and-so astronomical units away, you can work out what the astronomical unit is. So you can work out the astronomical unit by taking measurements of, say, Venus. Now, how can you measure distances to, say, Venus? Well, you can do by parallax. Okay? Well, how do humans measure depth? They use two eyes, and the slight difference in angle, the brain can convert that to distance. If you had two eyeballs, one at opposite ends of the Earth, okay, you could, in principle, and you could measure angles very, very accurately, which is a slight deviation. And if you could synchronize your two observations, you could exactly the same time. Then you could obviously where Venus is. So one good way is to wait until Venus, say, transits the Sun. Okay, so the moment Venus crosses the Sun, people on two sides of the planet measure the angle. Then they come back to their notes, you could work out the distance to Venus. Now, this is something which the ancient Greeks could not do because it requires quite a lot of technology. You need sextants, you need to measure the angle properly, you need some good timekeeping, reasonably good timekeeping, and you need the ability to travel across the globe. So this was first done by James Cook, famous explorer in Australia. Well, I can't believe he's known for discovering Australia, but the reason he discovered Australia was that he was trying to do science, in particular trying he was racing to the southern hemisphere to capture the transit of Venus at the same time as someone in London or Greenwich was doing it. He wasn't the only person, but he did something crucial measurements. Now, accidentally, he discovered Australia too, because it was a bonus. So that was the 18th century. That was the minimal time in which you had all the technology necessary to do all this. And they were able to measure the transit of Venus, and this actually gave the first accurate measurement of the AU. Okay, now we can do things much, much better. Okay, in particular, this creature called radar. If you just bounce a radar off of Venus, and you can measure astronomical unit to really, really high accuracy nowadays. But even in the 18th century, you get a pretty good estimate. Now, again, every time you make really precise measurements, you discover that your theory doesn't quite has some inaccuracy in it. So this all these measurements eventually revealed that something was going weird with Mercury. That Mercury actually was not obeying Kepler's laws. So Kepler couldn't detect this with his data, but eventually they worked out that Mercury was wobbling at a funny rate. It was precessing. The ellipse was wobbling a little bit, and so Newtonian gravity had to be fixed. And of course, this was a famous early verification of Einstein's theory of general relativity, which we'll need later on. Okay, so Earth, Moon, Sun. Okay, the next one is not technically a distance, but we need a very important number, speed of light. So you saw these pictures of planets and so forth. I need a picture of speed of light. This is the best I could come up with. Okay, it's not a distance, but it is something you really need to know to measure the later ones of the ladder. Now, this was hard to measure. In fact, it was not clear for a long time that even that it was even finite. I think Gauss proposed to measure the speed of light by, I think he got a friend to go up some mountain, and he would go on some other mountain at night, and he would unshut his lantern. He said, okay, the moment you see this light, you unshut your lantern, and I'm going to time how long it will take to see light come back, and I'm going to use this to measure the speed of light. Now, this didn't work, but the idea was sound. The idea actually was sound. It's just that the distances needed, also the reaction time of his friend, were just too inadequate. But the same idea actually works. Instead of using two mountains, use two planets, then it works. Now, of course, you can't get your friend to go with the other planet, but okay, so they used Jupiter. So the first measurement was done by Romer and Huygens. And so we used Jupiter. Okay, and so instead of your friend, who can't go to Jupiter, use someone who really is at Jupiter, which is the moon of Jupiter called Io. So Io is one of the four big moons of Jupiter. And it has a property that Galileo thinks it's those four moons. It's the closest one to Jupiter, so by Kepler's laws, it rotates the fastest. In fact, it rotates really fast. You know, our moon takes 28 days to go around the Earth. Jupiter, so Io only takes 42 hours. And it's like a clock, in, out. You can look at a telescope, and Io transits Jupiter in, out every 42 hours. Except that it doesn't. So Romer was actually trying to measure it precisely. He was measuring exactly when Io entered Jupiter's shadow and so forth. And it wasn't quite 42 hours. Sometimes it was a little bit ahead of schedule, sometimes a little behind schedule. Sometimes the transit came a little bit earlier than the period came later. And they eventually worked out that this happened when Jupiter and Earth were on the same side of the Sun. The transit was a little bit advanced. And we're on the opposite side of the Sun, with a little bit recessed. And so Huygens realized what was going on, and it's basically the two mountain story. So the difference is very slight. Okay, so you wait 6 months for the Sun to go going on the other side, and the difference is only 20 minutes. Okay, you need to measure a 20-minute time difference over 6 months, which by that point they had enough good clocks, they could actually do this. So Huygens realized what was going on is because light had a finite speed. And when the Earth was on the other side of the Sun, the light from Jupiter takes two extra astronomical units to get from Jupiter to the other side of the Sun. And so it takes 20 minutes to traverse two astronomical units. Okay? And that's enough information to compute at least somewhat accurately the speed of light. So they were the first to get a reasonably good estimate of speed of light. So they got 140,000 miles per second, which is, so the truth is 180,000 miles per second. So this is not great, but it is, they're the first to do it. Later measurements using similar ideas got better measurements, and they eventually got close to the right number. And eventually, much later, there were Earth-planet experiments that confirmed this. And this is, again, like many other astronomical data points in this talk, this led to another physical advance, important one, because Maxwell, at some point, had managed to unify electricity and magnetism using Maxwell's laws, and the laws predicted that electromagnetic waves propagate at a certain speed, which depends on the permittivity and permeability of space, and he computed the speed, and it was 180,000 miles per hour. So that number looks familiar. And so he looked up the best available estimate for the speed of light, and it was almost exactly the same. And so he made a very important discovery, which is obvious now, not obvious then. Light is a form of electromagnetic radiation. And this, of course, helped develop Einstein's theory of special relativity, helped develop spectroscopy, and both of these are needed for astronomy. So astronomy and physics have been in a symbiotic relationship for decades. Okay, so we've got as far as the speed of light. Now you can use that, use those information to get to nearby stars. Actually, in this particular case, you want to use light, they use AU. Okay, so So parallax, as I said, you could use two different points on the Earth to measure distances to planets. So in principle, you could try to do the same thing to measure distances to stars. You can take measurements of both Australia and England of the same star and try to measure parallax. But it doesn't work. If you try even the closest star, Alpha Centauri, the difference in angle between Fortuna is 10,000 arcsecond. Arcsecond is a 60th of a minute, and the minute is 60th of a degree. Okay. I think even modern telescopes are not good enough to measure this discrepancy. Because the closest star is actually about it's not like 2 or 3 AU away, it's 270,000 AU away. So the distance between two ends of the Earth is not good enough. But we can do better. So rather than travel to the other side of the Earth, we just sit in one place in the Earth and just wait 6 months. The sun will move you very hopefully 2 AU over to the right over here. And then you use these as your two eyeballs. Okay? And now you have a much greater parallax. And if you measure, and so if you have a good photography, you can take photographs of the same constellation 6 months apart, and some of the stars will lose slightly because of parallax. And with enough good photography, you can actually use this to measure distances to stars. But again, you need pretty good parallax. If you just use Earth-bound telescopes, you can get about as far as 100 light years away from the Earth this way. Which is good enough to get a fair bunch of stars. Nowadays, you can use satellites, and you can actually do a lot better. But you can initially, at least, you've got 100 light years. That's enough to get, so there's about 10,000 stars which are close enough for parallax to work. So that's a tiny fraction of all the stars in the galaxy. But that's a huge set of data points that you can use to climb the next rung of the ladder. Okay, again, this was first done, yeah, so one of the first things you need is an accurate telescope. And this was first done by Bessel in the 19th century. So I mentioned earlier that when Aristarchus proposed the heliocentric model, the other Greeks said this can't be true. Because if the Earth went around the Sun, and if the Sun was so far away from the Earth, you would see parallax effects. You would see that every 6 months, the constellation is slightly different because you're 2 AU over. And they saw the constellations, you know, they didn't change. And the only way they couldn't change is if the stars were enormously far away. And so far away, the universe was making hundreds and thousands of times bigger than they had thought. And this was clearly absurd. So, therefore, the Aristarchus model must have been wrong. Okay. But of course, we're completely correct. The stars are incredibly, incredibly far away. They just could not wrap their heads around it at such a distance. So sometimes if you trust the mathematics, even your intuition just goes completely awry. Okay, so the next thing is the Milky Way. So parallax only gives you like a tiny fraction of the Milky Way. Okay, it's like a thousandth inches of the way across or something of the full Milky Way. But once you have a partial set of data of stars, you can get the rest. This is another famous story taught in high school sometimes. So once you have really good, you have spectroscopy, which we talked about earlier, not only can you measure stars and where they are, you can also measure their color, the red or green or blue, at precise images of the frequency. And once you have good photography, you can measure how bright a star is, at least how bright a star looks. So some stars are bright because they really are bright. But sometimes they're bright because they're close to us. A star which is bright, in absolute brightness, is far away, has small apparent brightness. So if you measure apparent brightness, and there's inverse square law. The further away you get from a star, the dimmer it looks. And so for 10,000 stars, the stars that are close to us, we know their apparent brightness, and we know the distance by parallax. And so we can work out the absolute brightness of 10,000 stars nearby the Earth. So that's a lot of work, but somebody did it. Hertzsprung and Russell, two astronomers, took all the stars for which parallax was known. They computed absolute brightness of these stars, also their color. And when they plotted it, they got the Hertzsprung Russell diagram. They found that there's a curve, that there's some weird exceptions, but most stars, the main sequence stars, have a relationship between absolute brightness and color. Red stars are not as bright, blue stars are brighter. Okay, so they incredibly found this curve, the Hertzsprung-Russell curve. Now that's really useful. Every time you have a curve like this, you can use it in reverse. So once you have this curve, now you can measure distances to other stars that are too far from parallax to reach. Okay, because you take another star in the galaxy, you can still work out its color. You can't work out its absolute brightness directly, but you can work out its apparent brightness using the photography. And once you have this curve, this wonderful curve, once you know the color, you also know the absolute brightness. And once you know the apparent brightness and the absolute brightness, you solve using the square law, and that gives you the distance. So you can use the Hirschsprung-Russell diagram to work out the distance to all the stars in the galaxy. Yeah. So it works quite far out, about 300,000 light years, which is pretty much the entire galaxy. Beyond that, you run into serious problems. The stars are too faint, but actually worse than that, the stars that you can see outside the galaxy live next to all the other stars in the same galaxy. And it's really hard to work out the apparent brightness of that one star. So it doesn't quite work beyond the galaxy, but it works everywhere within the galaxy. So now you need to look at what happens to other galaxies. So first person to do this was Lee Deschambre, Henry Luswan Leavitt, who had a lot of trouble publishing as a woman, by the way. She had to basically publish under her advisor's name, but anyway, that's another story. So she was measuring a certain type of star called a Cepheid star. So first measured in Cepheus. So these are stars which are funny. They oscillate in brightness. Okay, so sometimes they were bright, sometimes they were small. But they didn't know why at the time, but they did oscillate in these variable stars. Now some of them were in the galaxy, in our galaxy, some of them were distant galaxies. So the ones which were in our galaxy, she could actually compute the distance to using the Hirschsprung-Russell diagram. So the Cepheids don't actually live on the Hirschsprung-Russell diagram, but they often live in clusters, but the clusters of other stars for which you can use the Hirschsprung-Russell method. So she could measure the distance to Cepheids within the Milky Way, and she could measure the brightness, and she could measure the period. Okay, so some Cepheids took a long time to oscillate, some took a short time, and so she could measure absolute brightness, and so she got another curve. So it turns out that there's two types of Cepheids, type 1 and type 2. But these types, there's a relationship between the period of the curve and the brightness of the curve. And this is, again, something that you can use just like you can use for the Hirschsprung-Russell diagram. That now, if you take a Cepheid which is far away, a different galaxy, you can measure its period. You don't need to measure apparent brightness, which is hard because we'll get all the other stars in the galaxy. If you measure its period, you use this, you can measure absolute brightness. Okay, no, you still need to actually measure relative brightness, actually. But the Cepheids are really bright. They're much brighter than most stars. And you can measure distances that way. And so this works. So the Milky Way is about 100,000 light years across. And Cepheids are really, really bright. And this method actually goes up to 100 million light years away. So this gets you a reasonable fraction of the universe, but not everything. So it gets you about 100 million light years away. The universe is about 76 billion light years in diameter, at least as far as we know. So, and most galaxies happen to have at least one Cepheid in them. So we can actually compute quite a lot of galaxies. So you need to go up one more ladder to get the final thing. We don't just use Cepheids. There's some other things that, so you need something so bright that you can actually work with it, even at distant galaxies. So another thing you use is supernovae. Okay. So final one, this is the final one we know of, is the entire universe. Okay. So so this is the thing I said at the very beginning. So the shape, to measure just galaxies which are too far away for Cepheids to work, was done by Hubble. So his story is quite famous, of course. So so he measured all these galaxies, and he noticed that some galaxies were redder than they should. Okay, so there's a certain color that was predicted by stellar evolution and so forth. But some galaxies have spectrum that was shifted from what should happen, and he computed this red shift. And there are thousands of galaxies for which it was close enough that Leavitt's method could work out the distance. So he plotted the red shift against the distance, and he got a curve, actually a line in this case. Not a great line, but later data you can sort of. So he discovered Hubble's law, that the further away the galaxy was, the more redshift it was. And so, again, once you have a curve, in this case a line, you can use it in reverse, take any galaxy, even if it's really far away, if you know its redshift, you can compute its distance. Okay? So now, every galaxy in the universe, you can now measure how far away it is. So one thing you discovered was that everybody's redshifted. Okay? Everyone's moving away from everyone else. And this was, of course, now he's famously explained by the Big Bang Theory, okay, that the universe is expanding, and so every point is receding from every other point. Of course, it's another famous advance in physics. But as I said, it also lets you measure distances. So finally, astronomy could only measure directions for centuries, but now just in galaxies, we can now measure directions and distances. So we can use polar coordinates, you can now start plotting the entire universe. Okay, so you can start making maps of the universe. Okay, every galaxy you see, you plot. So this is, I think, it's called a 2-degree field. You just sample an arc 2 degrees, you look at all the galaxies in that arc, and you measure the distance, and you plot polar coordinates, and you get all these galaxies, and you start finding that they're not uniformly distributed. Okay, they're not spread out uniformly in space. They clump into strings. So there are these massive superstructures in the universe, or entire galaxies condensed into strings. So this is called the Great Wall. Okay, so of course, it's the Great Wall of China. This is a much, much bigger wall. It's a wall of galaxies. But these are structures that you could not see unless you could measure distances. Okay, so it's something that you have to climb the entire ladder to start seeing. And so we are now beginning to understand what the entire universe is shaped like. There's other data that are very important too. This is the cosmic microwave background, which is another very important piece of data from the early universe. And so, for example, we can start measuring the rates of the universe. So the current best estimate is that the universe is about 78 billion light years or more. We don't have a lower bound. We don't have an upper bound. We also know that the age of the universe is pretty long, 14 billion years. Okay, now, initially we were using ancient Greek mathematics and ancient Greek technology. At this point, we are no longer using ancient Greek anything. So you really need pretty much 21st century mathematics and 21st century astronomy. You need general relativity, particularly at universe and cosmological scales. And you need really good telescopes, in particular, you can start putting them in space to get the right measurements. Hubble and WMAP, for instance. Next year there will be the James Webb Telescope, which you'll see in infrared, and very recently we can now measure gravitational waves. So that's going to be another huge advance. And so it's still going. Okay, we haven't completely mapped the universe yet. Okay, and so of course astronomy is extremely active nowadays still. So I just want to close where we are. So here are four pictures which I think are great for describing the state of astronomy today. Okay, so this map here, this is a famous map of Ptolemy. So Ptolemy, who we talked about earlier, 1st century AD, decided to try to make a map of the world. Okay, this is Ptolemy's map. So you've got Africa here, Asia here, Europe here. Now, Ptolemy did not actually travel to all these places. So the way he got this map, well, first of all, he bought every single map he could get his hands on and tried to stitch them together. But he also talked to merchants. So even in ancient Greek times, there were merchants who managed to get as far as Asia, or at least maybe get as far as say Persia, and the Persian merchant would go to China or whatever. And they could ask the merchant, these merchants, how many months did it take to get from, say, Athens to India or whatever. Okay, and that's a measure of distance. Okay, and you could start using that to make a very crude plot of the map of the Earth. And so, this is what he got. Now, it's not bad. Okay, so this is what the Earth actually looks like. And really, it's given the limited technology, this is an incredibly good map. In fact, for 1,000 years, it's pretty much the best map. Navigators will still use this map for centuries. Okay, now over here, as of like 2010 or so, this is the analog of Ptolemy's map. This is like one of the best maps of the universe we have right now. And it's a very similar thing. Like in 2-degree field, you measure all the distances and you plot as much of the universe as you can. This is sort of the analog of Ptolemy's map here. Now, over here should be a picture of what the universe actually looks like. I don't have that picture. Don't even know Wikipedia. Now, but what you can do is that you can run numerical simulations. Okay? You can simulate a big bang, lots of particles, use a supercomputer, each particle is a galaxy, you use gravity. You can't really use classical gravity, but you can mostly use classical gravity. And you will find that as you evolve these galaxies by just gravity, gravitational forces, they will organize into strings. Okay? And you can make numerical plots of numerical universes, and you see the same string of structures that you will be able to see over here. So that's great news. It tells you that we haven't screwed up massively, as you can find in this ladder. Okay, that the experimental data is still fitting with the theories that we have. But we still actually would like to have the analog of this picture here. We'd actually like to have the true map of the universe, and that we don't have yet. But maybe, all these new telescopes, eventually we will actually have a real map here. That'd be great. Okay, that's my talk. Thank you very much.
So we have time for a couple of questions. Yeah.
Oh, that's a good question. Maybe these are some of my major axes. I have to look up the precise definition. Nowadays, we don't actually use the AU as much. It was important before we had interplanetary satellites. And once you have satellites orbiting Venus or something, it's much easier to measure everything. So I guess AU is really a variable. It depends on season.
Over here.
So one thing you learn in academia is that people do not document their failures. They only publish what works. There's a sort of survivorship bias. And so there are other ancient Greeks who also had a go at these problems, and they got lousy answers, and I didn't talk about those. There are many other ingenious attempts to measure these numbers, and I just showed you the ones that worked. So I think there was a lot of trial and error. But also, these were very bright people, and so they found many things, and eventually someone worked. Okay, that's all I can say. How did I find them? Wikipedia? But, you can look at all this stuff. There are historians of science who chronicle the same. Copernicus knew about the work of Aristarchus and so on. All this work can be preserved. The work of the ancient Greeks got preserved by the Islamic world, and that which got back to Europe, which is very, very fortunate, actually. Science is a cumulative endeavor. We always build on the shoulders of previous centuries.
Maybe in the interest of time, one more.
Oh, they had some other, they had water clocks and a couple of other things. Maybe they used heartbeats, I don't know. There are some ways to measure that. Not very accurately, but they had some way to measure small things of time. They used music, actually.
Okay, well, let's thank Terry.